Hello, everyone. I am Kay Tyndall. I'm the director of the research development team with the Office of the Vice President for Research. I have with me Carrie Romo, who is Senior Proposal Development Administrator, as well as the Interim Director for the Research Park, and Dr. Patricia Solis, who is our Senior Research Associate with the Research Development Team. So I wanted to start this off by asking you, the audience, what is research development? What kind of activities involve research development? We are all research development professionals here. So what is it that we do? What can we do? What is in our repertoire of services? I'll give one example. Grant writing workshops, that's one thing. Industry collaborations and partnerships, building those. Alerting faculty of funding opportunities. Assisting with large-scale center-like proposals. Team science, which there is an entire field of researchers dedicated to the study of team science and all of the team dynamics, interactions, how do multidisciplinary teams collaborate. We will be attending the Science of Team Science conference this spring, I believe. And it's all focused on researchers and research development professionals working together in these large teams. Another part of research development is handling the limited submissions process for the entire university. Faculty development, facilitating collaborations between faculty at Texas Tech as well as between faculty at Texas Tech and other institutions. And there's a myriad of other possible things that are involved with research development. And we wanted to focus on one of our goals. One of our goals is multidisciplinary collaborations and breaking down the silos that are inherently built into the fabric of academia. And how do we leverage our research strengths and how do we build partnerships? So a few of the ways are catalytic research events, emerging interdisciplinary working groups, and large-scale proposal development assistance. Of the catalytic research events, one that I wanted to let you be aware of is Congressional Visits Day, which is March 17th and 18th, and I'll discuss that on the next slide. The Obesity Research Cluster Annual Meeting, which is scheduled for May 6th. The Obesity Research Cluster consists of 14 different departments at TTU, as well as three departments at the HSC and three schools at the HSC. So it's a very multidisciplinary group looking to expand even to our Health Sciences Center in Amarillo and El Paso, as well as other universities. Also, the UPTECH annual meeting. UPTECH is the Unconventional Production Technologies and Environmental Consortium, and it consists of over 15 departments at Texas Tech, as well as the School of Law. And these are two groups that are not classified as centers, as official centers, but they are research clusters or working groups that we will help support through event management, through helping with keeping the momentum going amongst the group members. The next catalytic research event is NSF Day, which Patricia will discuss in a few slides down, and the Early Investigator Proposal Workshop, which will be held summer 2015, which we'll also discuss later, and finally the Water Summit, which is scheduled for September or October, which Carrie will discuss. Other opportunities for collaboration, there's the Faculty Research Club that meets at the end of the month, the last Friday of every month from 4 to 5, and it's held in this room. We look for different sponsors to provide wine and crackers and cheese, and it's a a very interesting meeting where faculty from many different colleges come and talk about their research and the areas of opportunity that you can collaborate with them. And the other opportunity that I'm aware of is the Faculty Conversations, which is held, hosted by Michael San Francisco, the Dean of the Honors College. And it's the first Friday of every month, and it covers more than just research. It's everything related to academic life for faculty. So Congressional Visits Day, this is hosted by the Alliance for Science and Technology Research in America. The purpose is to raise visibility and support for science, engineering, and technology. One of the things that the Office of the Vice President for Research is doing is providing $500 travel stipends for faculty who are interested in joining these 2 days and want to meet with congressional members, congressional staffers. So if you or someone you know is interested in this, we have this announced on our OVPR homepage, and you can go follow the link to the application. Basically, we're looking for individuals who are interested in learning more about how to talk to congressional members and staffers, how to communicate your research. And if you're chosen for this travel stipend, then you will have to work with Sally Post, who will help with the communications, help develop the pieces that you will, the leave behind pieces for the congressional staffers and members. And there is also a 1.5 hour commitment to a workshop that will be hosted by Barry Brown and myself. And Barry helps us connect with congressional members, and he's based in D.C., so he knows the pulse of D.C., and he keeps abreast of all of the political ups and downs. And so he would provide an orientation, but this orientation will be open to anybody who's interested in joining, not just those that are chosen for the travel stipend. So if you're interested, you can either go to the homepage and find out more information, or you can send an email to rdt.vpr, and we can send you more information.
Hi. Good afternoon. Thank you for being here with us. Just a quick bit of information about NSF Day. As you know, NSF stands for the National Science Foundation, and they provide a very large amount of funding for researchers in many disciplines, and is very important federal agency for us to pay attention to. We're really happy to say that there is an event where they will send representatives from the National Science Foundation to Texas Tech here in Lubbock, and that's going to be May 19th and 20th is actually the dates that they're going to be around. And there will be some sessions where you can attend and learn how to engage with NSF, maybe get some hints about how to be more competitive, and speak directly with a variety of different directorates. So this is kind of your opportunity as a researcher to directly engage with an agency, and they like to disseminate information about their programs. And so whether you have a specific RFP in mind or you would just like to learn more about the NSF, I think this is a really great event for you. The registration is $50. There is a sign up on the website, or you can email the RDT VPR email site for more information. One's also mine. Here I am again. We also have an opportunity this June for early investigators, where we're going to do an intensive proposal development workshop. It's actually a 4-day event with 3 days in June and 1 day in August, where we're designing a very hands-on content. We'd like to have researchers who do have a particular opportunity in mind to work with and help go through a lot of different strategies from beginning to end on how to help improve the competitiveness. This is offered by the Office of the Vice President for Research, and we have a number of different of the departments within the office collaborating on this. including the research development team, as well as ORS and you know, other entities that are part of that proposal submission process. So one of the things that I'm looking forward to about this event is the tangible outcome. We're going to work with each of the participants so that they can have an actual proposal, a draft, that they'll be working on after the workshop, training in the summer. And then we will return together in August to look at those drafts and do sort of a mock review so we can go through that whole process. And ideally, at the end, we'll have a number of those submitted in the fall. So the application process has yet to be announced, so this is a sneak peek, but look for it soon in probably the Scholarly Messenger or the Tech Announce, and also on our website. You can send us an email about this too if you would like to just receive it directly.
So one of the other things that we're going to do in late September or early October is have our water summit. And this is a follow-up to the water workshop that we had in November. And we're looking to really expand this one to involve outside stakeholders, industry, agencies, regional landowners, and researchers. And we're moving past just talking about our current issues. We're wanting to really get into innovative solutions, technological opportunities, and searching out how industry needs can be met. And some of the topics that we're going to work on involving water is with agriculture, oil and gas, human and community needs for water, and just water issues with natural resources and ecosystems. But we're really looking to expand even past this. So I think it's going to be really interesting. So keep your eye out for a notice about this. So let's say you're involved in an interdisciplinary group that's wanting to host some kind of summit or symposium or something along those lines. We can provide the service to help you and help keep the momentum going and do some of the extra things that are needed to help out with that. I wanted to also draw your attention to the folders that we have for you. We have information on us, but then we also have some of the things that we've talked about. We have the Congressional Visits Day, and then we have a list of the emerging interdisciplinary working groups. And these groups are, there's a list of faculty that are involved in each of these groups. And this was coming out of a series of internal discussions that was hosted last summer, hosted by the VPR. And these are focused around major and emerging strengths. These are not strategic research initiatives that are put forth by the institution. Those are based on the president's cluster hires. These are groups that don't necessarily have interdisciplinary centers that have been established, or, for example, with the water group, there are several water centers, but they are based and housed in separate colleges. So this is a way for them to be virtually connected. And I have started setting up sites online for them to connect virtually, to start some discussions, do some information sharing, and see what comes out of these groups. Some of these are self-assembled groups where faculty have said, we have a group in this area, we want you to be aware of it, and so we've included those as well. If you or someone you know is part of an interdisciplinary group and wants to let us know, just send us an email. And one of the things that we're planning on doing once we hire an administrator is to send out funding opportunities to these groups so they can start building collaborations and start getting to the level where they might one day submit a large-scale center-like proposal. And then that list that's in your folder has all of the individuals that are involved in each group. And so the next thing I wanted to discuss was proposal development assistance. And as I said before, we will start a funding opportunities listserv. And this will not go out to all faculty, only those that are interested. And so if you are interested, send an email to rdt.vpr and include your research interests, areas of research expertise, and based on those, we will send emails to groups that we identified as being similar. So it can serve the purpose of two purposes, really. One of moving forward and being aware of grant opportunities that fit your areas of expertise, as well as seeing who else is also interested or has the same expertise, and maybe you can work collaboratively on some of these proposals. One of the things that the research development team does is manage the proposal development process, and these are for multidisciplinary, oftentimes multi-institutional proposals, large scale. They are very intense. There's a big need for coordination and communication, especially when the groups are interspersed between industry and faculty. They often don't speak the same language, and so we can help with that coordination and communication. And we also provide advice on the specific aims, the objectives, the timeline, things of that nature. Are you really communicating what you want to communicate in your proposal, and are you meeting all of the criteria that's outlined by the funding agency? We also have three grant editors that come from a various array of backgrounds. One has a PhD in humanities, I believe, and one has a background in science, and the other one has a master's in education. And these are not, there's no level of funding that is required to engage the grant editors. It can be a proposal of $500 to $500 million. They will help with any and all. And they are really fantastic. Just send an email to granteditor.vpr, and we will find the right one that matches your proposal and can help you out. And if we receive an influx of requests that all of the grant editors can't meet, then we will hire more editors, because I think this is a very valuable service that we provide. The other thing that we provide is resources. We have a repository of boilerplates and templates, and these documents are available to you at request. We don't have them posted online or anything, but we do keep them, we maintain them. Right now we're working with centers and departments across campus to get more data than what they post online. So what statistics do they think will help in showing that they have the expertise, showing that they have the capabilities, and things like that. So you can use those to develop your proposals, especially with facilities and resources and those kind of things. And you know, these areas of service, they will grow as the university grows. As interest increases, as demand increases, things change. And so we will always continue looking for new ways that we can help faculty.
One of the other things that our office handles is the limited submissions process. And if you don't already know what those are, limited submissions are RFAs that are put out by agencies, and they limit the number of applications that they'll accept from an applicant, which is TTU. So they may say they'll only accept one, they may only accept three. So we try to search these out and manage this process, because if more than the limited amount is submitted, most likely the agency will return them all without review. So we try to monitor that, and the way we do that is we search through listservs, we search through agency sites, and then we'll find that opportunity and post it on the web page, and give a date that we want a notice of intent for when you want to submit. Oftentimes I try to do it 2 weeks, but sometimes it's going to be less than that because the agency deadline is coming up quicker than I would like. And then you would submit a notice of intent, and if more people have submitted than the agency allows, then we'll hold an internal competition. The reviewers will rank their proposals, and then the highest scored will move forward. So we update the site weekly, and it's something that really needs to be checked through often. And right now we're running it through this website, and we have the email to submit notice of intent to, but we're working on a new site, a competition space. It's a program that should really manage the whole process. It will streamline it, and it'll keep a calendar and have a routing process, and we're really looking forward to being able to get this up and running, so keep your eye out for that.
Now we get to the fun part, where we can talk about different pieces of advice that each of us have for faculty researchers. And we each focused on one area of concentration. Mine is, don't sell yourself short. And the first way that you can sell yourself short that I thought of is in not thinking large enough. So there's the opportunity that if you were to increase your team, reach out to cross-collaborate and bring on interdisciplinary partners or other institutions, et cetera, that you can then maybe go after something that's larger than what you were originally considering. Also, there's a very important piece to all proposals called broader impacts. NSF requires that you label it broader impacts, but all of the agencies are looking at, will your proposal impact a broader audience than just your region? So it's important that you are reasonable. You can't exaggerate that you will reach the entire world or what have you, but you have to reasonably think of, how will my project go beyond changing science and scientific theory? How will it reach a broader audience? And that's one of the things that the research development team, as well as our grant editors, can do to help you in thinking about the scope and thinking about maybe you're going after something that, if you expanded it more, you could go after something that's larger. And the next way that you can sell yourself short is by wanting to do too much in too little time. I see this very often with early career investigators that go after some of these smaller grant proposals. Maybe they're 2 years in length and wanting to do their entire life's work in a 2-year period. And the reviewer comments that come back always say, this is too ambitious. There's no way that you can accomplish all of your goals and objectives in the timeline. And it's very true for some of these tiered proposals that some of the programs have development or feasibility studies, and then they also have another track for implementation or something where the proof of concept has already been proven, and then moving on to something broader. So it's important to make sure that you are actually planning everything, all that's in your objectives, that you will deliver. Because what if it is awarded and then the agency expects you to deliver in the 2 years and it takes you 3, 4, 5 months to get through your first objective? So it's important to think very reasonably about, is this feasible? Can I actually accomplish everything? And then finally, the last way that you can sell yourself short is by throwing your proposal in the trash when it's rejected by the federal agency. An NSF 2013 report said that on average, it takes 2.5 submissions before an award or a grant is funded. And that's on average across everybody. And then NIH also reports that the first time a grant is submitted, you have an 8% chance of success. I hope that all of you are in that 8%, but it's a small percentage. And the second time, it's 28%. The third time is 47%. So these statistics are true in that if you seriously consider the reviewer comments and look through what exactly can I do to strengthen and make my proposal have that competitive edge that's needed. So one of the things that a new service that the research development team is providing is reviewer comments analysis meetings. We don't have a good name for it yet, but we will soon. And what this is, it's for professors who had a recent declination for an award, and they are needing some help, a 30-minute meeting to just go through the reviewer comments and discern what are the comments that will actually provide the competitive edge and what is just an individual's opinion. It's very easy to and common to have a feeling of you're calling my baby ugly. I've worked many, many months on this proposal. It's, you know, I put so much time and energy into it, and it's rejected. And so the research development team can provide the objective view on the reviewer comments and help you work through that. So don't give up.
So my section is to pay attention to the signs. And when you're preparing a proposal, there are signs that can guide you in the right direction for submitting your best proposal possible that you really want to pay attention to. So there are many, but I'm just going to talk about a few of them. The first and, of course, most obvious one is to read and reread the RFA. These are the sponsor's directions for preparing and submitting an application. For example, the NSF will many times tell you exactly what sections you should have, how you should title them, what you should address in each of them, how long they should be. You want to follow these, and not only will it make things easier for you, at least helping you organize your thoughts and your proposal, but it'll make things easier for the reviewer to follow. You also want to look at the RFA to develop a checklist of the documents needed, and that's something that RDT will do if we're working for you. We'll go through that RFA. We'll list all the documents that are needed, the supplementary documents, what kind of attachments, tell you how long they'll need to be, try and give you a short summary of what needs to be in there. So that's just really something that you need to study to make sure you're submitting the best thing. Another sign that you'll notice is that the agency will always tell you who the program officer is and how to contact them. But is it okay to contact the program officer? Absolutely, it's okay. That's what they're there for. They're in the business of investing money wisely. One of the most important responsibilities they have is to talk to researchers. So they understand the mission and its priorities of the program. So when you contact them, they can give you an idea of whether your proposal is a right fit for their program, suggest another tract that it might fit into, and maybe even give you the contact information for that program officer. In October, Dr. Acacia Tang, an associate professor of psychology at UNM, came to speak. She was also an NSF program director, and she gave some really good advice about contacting the program officers. She said to start with an email, make sure you give them all of your contact information. This is especially true if you have an assistant writing the email for you. You want them to be able to get back to you if they need to. And give them some time periods in the next couple of weeks that they can contact you if they need to have questions or need to get more information. And you want to give a brief abstract of your proposal in the email so you can ask them if your ideas are a good fit with the program. They can give you guidelines and advice, and if their response is encouraging, then you want to follow up with a phone call where you can really get into the meat of your submission and see if they have any suggestions. One thing you really want to pay attention to a sign is how well your proposal is written. One common mistake that a lot of people make is that your writing is all over the map. There's a notion that if my idea is good enough, a little bit of bad spelling and bad grammar isn't going to be enough to get it kicked out. But if your writing is vague, unfocused, and sloppy, then they may not be able to ferret out what your good idea is. So some reviewers have been interviewed, and they said that this is one of the mistakes that particularly irritates them. Killer mistakes in grammar and spelling, or clear cut and paste jobs from different papers with inconsistent formatting and different writing styles. If it gives the reviewer an impression that you're not careful with your proposal, then how careful are you going to be with your research? And don't assume that just because these reviewers are knowledgeable in the subject that they're going to be experts and they'll just know what you mean or they'll get the gist. That's not always how it works. You really need to define your abbreviations and acronyms. Try not to use industry jargon. Explain your concepts and your ideas concisely and clearly. And a really important thing is to use the editors that are available to you. Kay told you all about them. We have their information. They're good at this. This is what they do. And they're not just there for the multidisciplinary, multi-million dollar proposals. So be sure to contact them or us if you need to use one of our editors. And as Kay talked about resubmitting, that is a direction you'll be considering is whether to resubmit. And like she said, less than 20% of proposals usually get funded. And of course, if it's the first time, it's even a less chance for that. So is it worth it to resubmit? Absolutely, yes. One of the good things, if there is a good thing that comes out of being declined, is that you get those reviewer comments that can help you. So pay attention to the comments. If methods or procedures can be fixed, then do it. If there needs more pilot data, then collect it. If you need to further demonstrate the feasibility, then add that in. Or if multiple reviewers tend to make the same type of comment, really pay attention to that and address it. Do what they ask, change what needs to be changed, add what they're looking for, and resubmit. And sometimes you may just think the reviewers are wrong. This is really good. They made a mistake. Sometimes it is just luck of the draw. As fair as they try to make the judging process, personalities, social dynamics, randomness can get in the way. So get in the habit of resubmitting, even if you think that the only way your proposal is headed is in that direction.
One of my favorite things ever is to give unsolicited advice, so this job is perfect for me. And I was thinking about, what kind of advice would I give to early investigators and seasoned grant writers alike? And that one thing that I would say is take risks. I think it's really, really important as a, not just as a grant writer, but also as a scientist. And there are a lot of buzzwords in this world, but I don't really know of any industry that is so replete with them as grant writing. And one of those is innovation. But how do you be innovative? You take risks. And I love this quote from Will Rogers that says, I don't know if you can read it, you've got to go out on a limb sometimes because that's where the fruit is. And I think that that's true for grant writing as well as for our research. The grant that you write is only going to be as good as the research that you're writing about. So when we think about this buzzword innovation and we talk about risks taking, there's also another component in there about creativity. And these are things that are not just innate talents of people. These are things that you can cultivate. And one of the things that I try to do as an investigator myself is to look at this on a day-to-day basis and not just wait for that moment when I'm trying to revise my proposal and try to put something new in there, but it's really about a mindset, trying to cultivate that creativity and risk-taking every single day. I like to think of it in terms of moving from the idea about we have a problem to solve as creating solutions. It sounds like the same thing, but it's not always the same thing. So taking risks. And as a team, we're here to help you as well, to try to inspire and motivate and say, would you consider a bigger proposal? What about this one? That's one of our jobs. Another thing about taking risks to keep an open mind about is the teamwork aspect, because I know it's difficult. It's usually much more complicated to engage across disciplines, but that is sometimes kind of a risk that you might want to take. And we are also here to kind of help mitigate that risk. Sometimes you can be afraid of asking a question that you think you're supposed to know about some other discipline, but you know those teams really work well when they are together, balanced, to have a sense of trust, and that's one of the things that we really are focused on with our work. I have a picture here of soup, and that is just to remind me to say that this is kind of my vision for how interdisciplinary teams work. It's not really about salad, where you just chop everything up and throw it all together. It has some kind of process of interaction between all those ingredients, and often you have to turn up the heat, give it a little time, and at some magic moment, really, there's things come together. And so having a little patience with that, taking that risk to trust your teammates and really making something out of it. And finally, I would reiterate the advice in terms of taking risks that you've heard before, which is get some feedback on this. And I think asking for that feedback is sometimes a little risky. We do get that feedback in the form of the reviewers, but why not be like the owl instead of the ostrich and take that 360 view in the design phase of it? You might not want to ask anybody or show anybody your ideas. I am the world's worst person at showing anybody a draft. I have to work on it and work on it before I feel ready to let anybody see it. But taking that risk of getting some input early on can really pay off in the end, and then you don't have to wait for the resubmission if maybe you got some good impact in the beginning. So we also can help with that. We do have reviewers, and again, the grant editors and ourselves, we can help with that strategic process.
So, do you all have any questions for us?
Can you just get a copy of the PowerPoint?
Yes, I will email it to you since I have your email address.
Mm-hmm. For the NSF Day, who will come?
I'm sorry?
Who is coming from the NSF Day?
Oh. Yes. So, it's based on faculty who sign up, who register for NSF Day. And based on those subdivisions of researchers, then the NSF program officers will be, I think there's 8 of them that will come, and they will be based on who are the people that are wanting to participate. So there's the morning time of NSF Day is focused on more presentation, and the afternoon is breakout sessions with a program officer that's directly related to your field of study.
So if you want to get biology, sign up some biologists.
Yeah, there you go. It's a critical mass you have to reach. No questions? Okay, well, thank you all for coming, and we will follow up with each of you individually and see how we can help you further. So thank you very much.